Sally Hemings, without a doubt, is and remains the most controversial blot on the reputation of Thomas Jefferson. She is most famous for, and her reputation lies in, being known as Thomas Jefferson's mistress. However, coining her as Thomas Jefferson's mistress implies that there was a consensual relationship between the two of them. Thomas Jefferson was a founding father and is generally known as an important figure regarding the American Revolution and early American history. He is typically described as the author of the Declaration of Independence and the third President of the United States. However, throughout his achievements, it is important to recollect that Thomas Jefferson owned over 200 slaves in his 83 years of life from 1745 to 1726. The majority of his slaves were kept on his Monticello plantation in Virginia, one of these slaves being the infamous Sally Hemings. In 1735, 8 years before Thomas Jefferson's birth, a man named Hemings, a white English captain of a trading ship, fathered a daughter with a, quote, full-blooded African woman. The African woman's name was Elizabeth. The mother and the daughter both ended up as slaves of the Epps family, the Epps family from which John Wales, who was the father-in-law of Thomas Jefferson, would marry his first wife, Martha. In 1746, the year that John Wales married Martha Epps, Elizabeth Hemings, the daughter of the, quote, full-blooded African woman, then only about 11 years old, moved onto the Wales property. Together, Martha and John Wales had together one daughter, Martha, who would later become Martha Jefferson. After the death of Martha, John Wales married two more women. But in 1761, Elizabeth was taken by John Wales into concubine, and she bore him 5 children. Robert Hemings, James Hemings, Thenia Hemings, Cretia Hemings, and Peter Hemings. The last child born to John Wales and Elizabeth, his slave, was Sally Hemings, who was born in 1773. 30 years earlier to the birth of Sally Hemings in 1773, Thomas Jefferson was born in 1743. In case you are getting confused, here is a small run-through. Here is the family tree. As you can see, the white trading captain and the full-blooded African woman, both of which we have no idea what their names are, made Elizabeth. Elizabeth Hemings and her mother both became slaves of Martha Epps. Martha Epps was the wife of John Wales. The only child of John Wales and Martha Epps was Martha Wales. Martha Wales later married Thomas Jefferson and became Martha Jefferson. However, after the death of Martha Epps, John Wales then brought his slave, Elizabeth, into concubine. Elizabeth gave birth to 6 children from John Wales. The last of the children was Sally Hemings. Essentially, what you need to know is that Sally Hemings was a half-sister of Martha Jefferson. Throughout his marriage to Martha Jefferson, Thomas Jefferson acquired more slaves and later received Elizabeth Hemings, whose daughter Sally would be born months later after the death of John Wales. Martha Jefferson chose to keep the Hemings family together after her father's death by bringing them onto her land. Unfortunately, on Friday, September 6th, Martha Jefferson died at Monticello. Around her, to her dying breath, was Elizabeth Hemings and her daughter Sally Hemings, who was to witness his death at not quite the age of 10 years old. Among one of the last things she did, Martha handed Sally a tiny silver servant bell as a gift. 2 years after the death of his wife, in 1784, Thomas Jefferson accepted a position as ambassador of France. He brought with him his eldest daughter, Martha Patsy Jefferson, who was only then 11 years old, and James Hemings, who was a brother of Sally Hemings. One of Jefferson's intentions in bringing James to France with him was to teach him to be a cook of French food, which he could later make at Monticello. June 26, 1787, during his 3rd year in France, Jefferson received word that his youngest surviving daughter, Lucy Elizabeth Jefferson, had passed away from whooping cough at the age of 2. At the death of Lucy Elizabeth, Jefferson then requested that Mary Polly Jefferson, whom he left in the company of family along with his now-deceased younger daughter, Lucy Elizabeth, be sent over to France to join him and his eldest daughter, Patsy, in an attempt to recreate his family. Polly arrived in London and was handed into the care of Abigail Adams. With the youngest Jefferson was Sally Hemings. In quotes, "The old nurse whom you expected to have attended her was sick and unable to come," Abigail Adams wrote to Jefferson. She has a girl about 15 or 16 with her, the sister of the servant you have with you. Abigail also told that, quote, Sally was quite like a child and required more care than Polly, who was 5 years younger. She also inquired about sending Sally back to Virginia. There are no known images of Sally Hemings. On arrival in Europe, Sally was 14 years of age and had very light skin, quote, almost white, and, quote, very handsome, with long straight hair down her back. There was some resemblance between Sally Hemings and Jefferson's late wife, Martha Jefferson, and Abigail Adams described Sally as, quote, she seems fond of the child and appears good-natured. She most likely ran errands and served as a chambermaid as well as a seamstress. She also accompanied Patsy and Polly to dances and dinners. And Jefferson spent a considerable sum in 1789 on clothing for Sally. Since her arrival in France, Sally had been paid some small wages, 12 livres a month for 10 months. Jefferson had bought clothing for her, as previously stated, and had her inoculated against smallpox. Sally's day routine is less clear, though she may have served the Jefferson daughters as a maid at the Covenant School during part of the time in Paris. It was during the years of 1788 and 1789 that Thomas Jefferson began his sexual activity with Sally Hemings, who was then only 15 or 16 years old. The emotional content of the Jefferson-Hemings relationship is a mystery. Some say he loved her and vice versa. Others argue it was coercive, institutionalized rape. If someone is your property, it is impossible for you to ask consent before sexual acts because they are property to you. Property cannot give consent. No consent before sex is rape. And all those who were slaves brought into concubine with their masters were raped. Property cannot give consent because they are owned by another human being. It was not love between Sally Hemings and Thomas Jefferson. It was rape. Property cannot give consent. Sally Hemings might have been doing what she had to do to survive an evil system, accepting sexual duty as an element of her enslavement and using what leverage she had to improve the lot of her children. Sally was a, quote, light-colored and decidedly good-looking. What little evidence of her suggests that she was an intelligent, brave woman who did as much as she could with what little the world had to give her. A later account, according to Madison Hemings, who is a son of Hemings and Jefferson, Sally was pregnant at the time Jefferson was going to return to the United States. He desired to bring her back to America, but she, quote, demurred. She was just beginning to understand the French language, and in France, she was a free woman and refused to return with him. Quote, to induce her to do so, he promised her extraordinary privileges and made a solemn pledge that her children should be freed at the age of 21 years, Madison Hemings recalled. Sally agreed, and she returned to Virginia. The most common argument used against Sally Hemings is that she had the choice of staying in France instead of returning back to Virginia. It is others blaming Sally Hemings for not escaping what she could have escaped. However, it is vital to recollect that Sally Hemings was only 16 years old, barely understood the French language, and all of her family was back in Virginia. She'd be all by herself. Soon after the arrival in Virginia, she gave birth to a child, and it lived a very short time. In total, she would give birth to 4 other children, her master the father to all of them, Beverly Hemings, Harriet Hemings, Madison Hemings, and Eston Hemings. The pact and promise that he gave to Sally Hemings, quote, the most important pacts of his life, was also a pact to James Hemings. To James Hemings, Jefferson promised to free him as soon as he trained another slave at Monticello with the skills he had acquired in France, those skills being his art in the cooking of French cuisine. As Jefferson came home in September of 1789, expecting to be in Virginia only briefly, it is possible that Sally wished to visit her relatives, after which she would return with him to Paris. There is a theory that Patsy Jefferson, whom was very close with her father, married so soon after her return to America because she was reacting to her father's liaison with Sally Hemings. The daughter may have felt disassociated to her father's affections, considering she was only 1 year older than Sally Hemings. During Thomas Jefferson's appointment as Secretary of State under President George Washington, Sally Hemings stayed at Monticello. Her main work was the care and tending to Jefferson's private rooms, drawers, papers, and wardrobes. The precise location of her living quarters is unknown. She may have lived in one of the new log servant houses on Mulberry Row, though during Jefferson's presidency, she is thought to have slept in the South Terrace wing. Sally Hemings was pregnant early 1795. In October, she gave birth to a daughter, Harriet. There, on July 11, 1797, Sally gave birth to a son. The baby was called William Beverly, called Beverly. In a letter dated January 22, 1798, Patsy announced the death of Harriet Hemings, the 2-year-old daughter of Sally. Patsy said nothing of the parentage. August 1799, Sally was pregnant with another child. The unnamed daughter did not live long and was born in December of 1799. There is no doubt that Jefferson was the father of these children, for he was always home 8 to 9 months prior to the birth of each of these children. Jefferson was never in love with Sally. He was simply her master, getting what he wanted. Sally was never in love with him either. She was bound to him. Knowledge of Jefferson's relationship with Sally Hemings was a topic of conversation in Charlottesville and among Virginia's politicians. Wednesday, September 1st, 1802, in the Richmond Recorder, a newspaper, James Callender, who once looked up to Jefferson, turned on his idol after not receiving the position he wished to receive. Callender got his revenge and published an account of the Jefferson-Sally relationship. Jefferson never directly responded to the charge, though in a private letter written in 1805, he denies the accusations. Quote, "For Jefferson, the code of silence on the issue of sex across the color line seems to have been total." A quote by John Meacham. Jefferson, quote, "coolly recorded the births of the Hemings children in his farm book, along with the other details of the lives of his slaves, of his crops. He was not in the habit of showing any kind of fatherly affection to us children," quote from Madison Hemings. According to a grandchild of Thomas Jefferson, quote, "the resemblance was so close that at some distance or in the dusk, the slave, dressed the same way, might be mistaken for Mr. Jefferson. Jefferson was the code of denial that defined life in the slave-owning states." Many years prior, in February 5th, 1796, Jefferson kept his promise and signed a deed of manumission for James Hemings. He was 31 years of age. James Hemings was unable to find a purpose for his existence. Although originally headed to Philadelphia, he soon may have traveled to Paris. Jefferson spoke with him more than a year later when James returned to Philadelphia. Jefferson was elected president, and a few days later, reaching out to James, who worked as a cook in a Baltimore tavern, asked if he would like to come to Washington. James's reluctance to leave Baltimore may have been because he formed a, quote, attachment. A few months later, James turned up at Monticello to run the kitchen during Jefferson's long summer. He was paid $20 a month, which was more than double his previous wage. James left Monticello in September of 1801, and a little over a month later, James Hemings committed suicide and died at the age of 36. Thomas Jefferson died on July 4, 1826, at the age of 83. With him at the time of his death were many members of the Hemings family. His coffin had been made by John Hemings, the 50-year-old brother of Sally. Of the 4 children of Jefferson and Sally who survived to adulthood, Beverly and Harriet had been allowed to leave Monticello in the early 1820s. Harriet married a white man in Washington City and raised a family of children. Madison was freed in Jefferson's will and ultimately moved to Ohio, as did Eston, eventually settling in Wisconsin, changing his name to Eston Jefferson and declaring himself white. In his will, Jefferson also freed 3 other members of the Hemings family, Burwell Colbert, John Hemings, and Joe Fawcett. Jefferson freed no other slaves, not even Sally herself. After his death, Sally moved to Charlottesville and lived without incident as a free woman. She died in 1835, giving a few mementos to her children of Jefferson's, a pair of his glasses, an inkwell, and a shoe buckle. Nobody knows where Sally Hemings is buried. In later years, many have tried to suggest that it was Jefferson's cousin, who resembled Jefferson very much, who was the father of Sally's children. Those were finally proven wrong
in 1998 with DNA findings and subsequent reevaluation that confirmed the, quote, relationship. DNA tests confirmed that a male in Jefferson's line, not one of the suggested nephews, was the father of at least one of Sally's children. The room where it is believed Sally Hemings slept was just steps away from Jefferson's bedroom. But in 1941, caretakers of Monticello turned it into a restroom. It wasn't until recently that the floor tiles were taken up and it was turned into a room dedicated to Sally Hemings. It was a liaison long denied by, quote, mainstream white historians who have a failure to believe that a founding father and author of the Declaration of Independence, the greatest freedom document in America, is just who Sally Hemings remind us he is. A hypocrite. But Sally Hemings' memory shall live on in the lives of slaves who experience the same ordeal.